Okay, let's start. So hello, everybody. I'm Nicolás Bernal from the Universidad Antonio Nariño in Bogotá, Colombia. And it's a pleasure to have you, all of you guys here today with Óscar Macías from Virginia Tech University. Óscar will tell us about all that we always want to know about the GV Galactic Excess. So I think Oscar, you can get started.
Okay, excellent. Okay, thanks, Nicolas, for the introduction, and it's wonderful to be with you guys in this opportunity. So let me share my screen. Let's share my screen. So, can you guys see my slides?
Yes, it's working.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so let's start. Okay, so. At the beginning of the 1900s, Lord Kelvin tried to estimate the amount of dark matter in the Milky Way by describing the stars of our galaxy as gas particles. And Henri Poincaré was very impressed with Lord Kelvin's idea, and commenting for a French journal, he apparently coined for the first time the term dark matter. So back in those days, dark matter referred merely to some sort of astrophysical material that happened to be too faint to be observed with our instruments. However, nowadays there is a wealth of gravitational information that indicates that dark matter cannot be composed of the kind of matter we are made of. So there are many dark matter candidates that have been proposed over the last few decades, and perhaps the best motivated ones are the so-called WIMP particles. So WIMP stands for weakly interacting massive particles, and these particles arise naturally in modes that seek to extend the standard model of particle physics, and they possess the correct relic density to explain the amount of dark matter we see today. So if these particles, if the WIMP particles have masses of about a few GeVs, then they could potentially self-annihilate and produce gamma ray signals that could be detected with the Fermi-Lab telescope. So the Fermi-Lab telescope is a space-based gamma ray telescope that scans the whole sky every 3 hours. It does so in the energy range between 20 megaelectron volts and about 500 GeVs, and it has a spatial resolution that increases with energy. So the highest intensity of dark matter is expected to be at the galactic center, but this is also a place where the uncertainties are highest. There are other places where one can look for dark matter, like dwarf spherical galaxy clusters and even the extragalactic gamma ray background. And in general, one needs to make a compromise between large statistics and background uncertainties. So during this talk, as Nicolas commented, we'll be mainly referring to the galactic center. Okay, so this is an optical image of the plane of our galaxy, and the galactic center is here close to the Sagittarius constellation. So this region was first identified in 1951 by astronomers Paddington and Minette. Essentially, this region was identified through the discovery of the Sagittarius A source. So throughout the study of the unique radio signals of the source, and because of its precise coincidence with the rotating hydrogen disk of the source with the dynamical center of the rotating hydrogen disk, this region was identified. So later in 1974, astronomers Balick and Brown discovered the unresolved source Sagittarius A star, which we now know coincides with the supermassive black hole in our galaxy. Okay, so observations with the Fermilat of the galactic center have uncovered a gamma ray excess that peaks at about 1 to 3 GeVs, and that whose maximum intensity coincides with the dynamical center of our galaxy, from where it falls off as a radial power law with a slope of 2.4. So given these spectral and morphological characteristics, the Galactic Center Excess can be explained with a dark matter model governed by a Navarro-Frenk-White profile. So the wind particles that feed the excess have typical masses of about 10 to 100 GeVs, but there are some other astrophysical explanations that people have put forward. The Galactic Center Excess was first claimed by Guinoff and Cooper in 2009, and since then many research teams have essentially confirmed their original claim. And in fact, the Fermilab collaboration recently, almost 1 year ago, confirmed the existence of the excess, and there is essentially an overall consensus that the properties of the Galactic Center Excess depend on the modeling of the galactic diffuse emission. So this is a gamma ray image of the whole sky, and to our purposes, the main components making up the gamma ray sky are the gamma ray point sources and the galactic diffuse emission. So these gamma ray point sources are compact objects that cannot be resolved by the Fermi instrument. These are objects like AGNs, pulsars, and supernova remnants, and others. And the galactic diffuse emission is essentially the gamma rays produced by our own galaxy. And we have here the tentative dark matter emission that we want to find out from the sea of photons. So, importantly, the galactic diffuse emission is expected to have an intensity which is at least two orders of magnitude higher than the best, the most optimistic estimates for dark matter emission. So we anticipate that disentangling a dark matter signal from the galactic center involves having a very deep knowledge of the galactic diffuse emission in our galaxy. So the galactic diffuse emission is produced by the interaction of cosmic ray particles with interstellar gas and with interstellar radiation fields. And so when high energy protons interact with gas, they produce neutral pions, which almost immediately decay into gamma rays. Similarly, high energy electrons and positrons upscatter ambient photons into high energies in a process that we call inverse Compton. And the same electrons and positrons accelerating into the Coulomb field of interstellar gas produce Bremsstrahlung emission. So these are the three main components making up the galactic diffuse emission. So there are two methods that people have used to model the galactic diffuse emission in our galaxy. And the first one, which I shall call the empirical approach, corresponds to the realization that the cosmic ray particles uniformly penetrate all the gas phases in our galaxy. And what that means is that the gamma rays coming from every direction can be modeled as a superposition of empirical templates. So namely, gas column density templates, a template describing the inverse Compton emission, and some isotropic, anisotropic template, and some other, which I will describe a bit later. The second approach is the parametric approach, and this corresponds to the solution of the diffusion equation for cosmic ray particles. The advantage, So people use numerical codes like Galprop. It's probably the Gordon rule to solve this problem. And the advantage of this method is that it produces physically motivated solutions, but unfortunately is much harder to account for the systematic uncertainties with this parametric approach. So because the empirical method provides a much robust way to account for the systematic uncertainties, we choose this method in our analysis. I should also mention that this is the method that the Fermilab collaboration uses in the construction of the official galactic diffuse emission model published by the Fermilab team. Okay, so more specifically, in our analysis, we use gamma ray data taken from the inner 15 degrees by 15 degrees region of the galactic center. We use almost 7 years of Fermilab data. And in our empirical approach, we assume that the data is made of a linear combination of gas cream density templates, of an inverse Compton template as predicted by Galprop, a loop one template. So this is a large scale structure seen in gamma rays, and a template accounting for the Fermi bulge. So these are some giant lobes that extend up to 7 kiloparsecs away from the galactic plane into both northern and southern hemispheres. And of course, we also account for the gamma ray pulsars. There are some more templates that we include in our analysis, but I'm showing probably the main ones. Okay, so the gas correlated photons are modeled with a combination of gas column density templates. So in order for us to account for the galactocentric cosmic ray gradient, so the galactocentric gradient of cosmic ray flux, we divide the gas maps in different annuli. So at every annulus, we assume that the cosmic ray properties are constant. We then include these gas templates into our maximum likelihood analysis, and the normalization that we get from this likelihood analysis represents the gamma ray intensity. So there is freedom in how many annuli we want to use, and we have found that dividing the gas maps in 4 different annuli is optimal. Okay. So about 90% of the baryonic mass of our galaxy is in the form of atomic hydrogen and molecular hydrogen. Here in this cartoon representation, the pink is the represents the atomic hydrogen, and these are the molecular clouds of molecular hydrogen. So we can trace the atomic hydrogen because with its 21 centimeters line emission. But since the molecular hydrogen doesn't have a permanent dipole, we cannot reliably trace it directly. So instead, we use the observation that molecular hydrogen is well mixed with carbon monoxide, and we can use the 2.6 millimeter emission of carbon monoxide to infer the distribution of gas particles in our galaxy. So, in order for us to construct these gas rings or these gas annuli, we need to know, one, the distance at which a certain gas cloud is, and two, the mass of that gas cloud. So from astronomical surveys, we can know the gas cloud velocity. So, and we can also know the gas cloud temperature. So the gas cloud velocity can be learned by the Doppler shift of the relevant line emission. And then we assume, so people usually assume that the gas clouds follow a circular orbit around the galactic center, and then we can establish a simple relation between the line of sight velocity of the gas clouds and the distance to the galactic center. So remember that this velocity can be obtained with this Doppler shift. So we can obtain the distance to the gas cloud. And by solving the radiative transfer equation, we can obtain a relationship between the gas column density or the mass of the gas cloud and the temperature. So we assume a certain spin temperature for the gas cloud, and we can obtain the mass or the gas column density for the gas clouds. Okay, so it is now well established that our galaxy is a barred galaxy. So there is a bar of stars in the galactic center, and the gravitational potential of this bar of stars induces highly non-circular motions towards the galactic center. So definitely the assumption of circular velocity for the gas clouds in our galaxy is incorrect in the inner region of our galaxy. So to solve this problem, the Fermilab collaboration have used an interpolation method. And so in this interpolation approach, what they do is they calculate the average gas close to the galactic center. And so in the boundaries in the Lanux side, in the boundaries of the Lanux side direction toward the galactic center, and then they interpolate the gas across the boundaries. Then they, what they do is they renormalize the amount of gas towards this direction so that the total amount of gas is preserved in the galaxy. So to the best of my knowledge, all previous works doing analysis of the galactic center have used this interpolation method to account for to obtain the amount of gas in the galactic center. And but there is a totally different method. This was pioneered by one of my collaborators, Martin Paul, and this method uses hydrodynamical simulations to gain kinematical resolutions in the galactic center. So in this, so this method introduces a probabilistic deconvolution method to assign gas cloud distances by gas flow simulations, and these simulations assume a certain gravitational potential for the spiral arms. And they also account for the galactic bar in our galaxy. So as we can see here, there is kinematical resolution towards the galactic center. So what we are showing here is, so we use the two methods. We use the interpolated approach, and we use also the hydrodynamical approach to construct the gas maps in the different annuli. And what's interesting to see is that there are differences between the two approaches for every for almost every annulus. And so then what we do in our analysis is that we include the two different methods, the two different gas maps. So we use the hydrodynamical gas maps, we also use the interpolated gas maps, and we find that we run our maximum likelihood analysis, and we find that the hydrodynamic gas maps are preferred almost every energy beam. In fact, we find that the hydrodynamic gas maps are preferred with a improved the fit in a 35 sigma. So then, we now know that the hydrodynamical gas maps describe the galactic diffuse emission much better, and then we start looking for additional emission. So first we start looking for residual point-like emission, and so what we do is we divide our region of interest. This is a 15 by 15 degrees region of interest around the galactic center, and we divide this region in a grid of 0.1 degrees squares, and at every pixel we place a putative point source with some general properties. Then we run the maximum likelihood analysis with and without the source, and for every pixel we assign a TS value, so a test statistics value. So this TS value is simply the difference between the log likelihood of the source and without the source, and essentially the square root of this value gives the significant detection of a point source in a certain pixel. In this sense, if we find a pixel with a TS of 25, so a square root of 25 is 5, so that will be 5 sigma significant detection for a point source in that given pixel. So with this technique, we find 43 new point sources in the galactic center. So these 43 new point sources are the green crosses, and the white crosses are the known gamma ray sources discovered by the Fermi-Ladd collaboration in this region. So we also did some multi-wavelength analysis to look for counterparts of the new point sources we found in the galactic center. And we found that for 7 of them, there are multi-wavelength counterparts. So we find that most of them correspond to globular clusters. There is a couple of pulsars, and there is also one supernova remnant. So this doesn't mean that for the remaining 36 gamma ray point sources, that the remaining 36 point sources are not real, since most of the gamma ray sources discovered by the Fermi-Nat coloration in this region are actually unassociated sources as well. Okay, so there is another interesting feature of this residual TS map, and is that there is some indication for some extended residual emission in the galactic center. And what one would expect if we were seeing dark matter is that this residual emission was spherically distributed around the galactic center. But in fact, we find this interesting shape, which resembles something like an X. So I'll come back to this point a bit later in the talk. So our galaxy is a spiral galaxy, and about a third of all the galaxies in the universe, when seen edge on, present a bulge morphology that resembles a box. And so these, the bulge of these spiral galaxies are called the this is called the boxy or peanut morphology, and some other people also call this the X-shaped morphology of the spiral of the galactic bulging spiral galaxies. So in fact, astronomers Nathan Lang did analysis with the WISE data, and so the WISE telescope looks at the sky in the infrared wavelength, and they uncover an X shape in our galaxy. So these X shapes are well understood, and people, Portal et al, have run n-body simulations of stars, and they have shown that dynamical instabilities in the galactic bar send stars of the galactic bar into orbits that contribute to this overdensity in the infrared. So these are stable orbits of stars, and in fact, they have estimated that the amount of mass in stars contributing to this X in our galaxy corresponds to about 45% of the total mass of our galactic bulge. There is another interesting population of stars in the galactic center. This is in the so-called nuclear bulge stars. These are measured by the Suharto telescope, and they leap in the inner 230 parsecs of our galaxy. Here, interestingly, there is ongoing star formation, while in the X corresponds to some of the oldest stars in our galaxy. Okay, so then in our analysis, what we did was we included the gas maps, the hydrodynamic gas maps. We also included the new point sources that we found in our analysis, and then we run our maximum likelihood analysis. Then what we are showing here is the full data minus the best fit or best fit model, accounting for the new point sources and for the hydrodynamical gas maps. And what we are left with is with the residual gamma ray emission in the galactic center. So the residual, and so on top of this residual emission shown in red, we plot the contour plots. So we chose some contours from the infrared image discovered by Nathan Lang. And we also plot the contours of this star population in the nuclear bulge. And so we find a striking correlation between the gamma ray residuals and the X shape. Okay. So then we normalize this X, this infrared X shape, and include that into our maximum likelihood analysis, and compute the gamma ray flux spectrum. So this is simply the distribution of photons as a function of energy in our galaxy, and in the center of our galaxy. The red boxes show the spectrum for the X shape, and the black boxes show the spectrum, the total spectrum for the 43 new point sources we find in our galaxy. So the sum of these two components makes up these green boxes, and we find that up to systematic uncertainties, the superposition of these two new components agree almost perfectly well with the Galactic Center Excess as shown in previous works. Okay, so then what we do is we show here the spectrum of all the components we include in our analysis. And what's interesting to take from here is that once we account for the this X shape, there are no residuals left in the galactic center. So this X shape really corrects the so accounts for the galactic center excess. Okay, so what we are showing here is now we are looking for the evidence for dark matter in the galactic center. In this top panel, we show that when we use the interpolated gas maps and we do not account for the new X component in the galaxy, we essentially reproduce the previously known galactic center excess spectrum. And here we show the TS distribution, and we show that we agree with previous works in that the galactic center excess peaks at about 1 to 3 GeVs. Okay, so now we repeat, now we repeat the same analysis by taking into account the hydronic gas maps, and we also include the X bulge and the nuclear bulge stars. And we find that the as the remaining spectrum for the dark matter is basically destroyed. And this shows that the same thing happens for the TS distribution. So the TS distribution is basically destroyed. And if we convert this TS distribution to significant detection, we find that there is essentially a one sigma, only one sigma significant detection for dark matter in the galactic center. Okay, so what happens now is that the stars that are contributing to the X are some of the oldest stars, and neutron stars or millisecond pulsars are rapidly rotating neutron stars that are more likely to live in places where there are high densities of stars and where there are old populations of stars. So this X shape, so we expect that this X shape, so we expect that there should be an unresolved population of millisecond pulsars in this X, and also in this nuclear bulge, as the as in the nuclear bulge there is a mixture between old stars and there is also a star formation activity, so there should be also millisecond pulsars in the region. And so we believe that this is showing evidence for the existence of unresolved population of millisecond pulsars there. So we also find that the overall spectrum for the X shape in our galaxy is consistent with the average spectrum of millisecond pulsars known in our galaxy. So the average spectrum of the resolved millisecond pulsars discovered by the Fermilat team. And here we make some back of the envelope calculations for the luminosity to mass ratio of the millisecond pulsar population. So using the luminosity function from Winter et al., we find that this is the luminosity for the total millisecond pulsar population of our galaxy, and this is the luminosity from a globular cluster called 47 Took, which is millisecond pulsar dominated, and we find that the luminosity we infer from the X is consistent, is consistently between these two luminosities. So that's some sort of indication for what we are seeing. Okay, so for those of you who are interested in looking into more detail of our analysis, I will refer you guys to this archive identifier. This is the list of my collaborators, and I want to pass now to the conclusions. So we have shown that the galactic center excess is not spherically symmetric distributed, and so dark matter is no longer favored at the galactic center. We have also shown that the hydrodynamical gas maps are a much better description for the galactic center. And we also showed that there is new evidence for an unresolved population of millisecond pulsars at the galactic center. Okay, so that's all, guys, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Oscar, for this super interesting talk. So first, I want to remember that you guys can ask questions via the Q&A system of YouTube, and also via Twitter using the hashtag Latin American Webinars on Physics, LAW Physics. So do you have questions now for Oscar from the audience?
I do have a question. Can I?
Yes, please go.
Okay. Well, Oscar, very nice talk and very amazing.
Okay, thanks. Thanks.
Very impressive. I have a question regarding the millisecond pulsar interpretation. I think all the pulsars, they have a cutoff, and I don't think there is any millisecond pulsar with the production emission above 10 GBs in your spectrum. You detect some emission above, I don't know, 5 GBs or things like that. It's hard to reproduce with known millisecond pulsar. Is it possible that there is some kind of different emission of
second
pulsar in the galactic center or something like that?
Right. So let me go back to the galactic center test that was previously known in this integrated gas map. Can show you the previously known spectrum in the galactic center. Okay, so this is a previously known spectrum, and so definitely this spectrum can be fit with a dark matter model, but it has been shown that the average spectrum of the millisecond pulsars can also easily account for this spectrum. So what happens is that this spectrum peaks at 3 GBs, and it rapidly falls off, and there is actually a cutoff at close to 10 GBs. So that's something. And so now, as we have more data, we have been able to resolve points also at higher energies. But in principle, millisecond pulsar, the millisecond hypothesis is completely valid for the galactic center. However, I agree that millisecond pulsar is not the only hypothesis to resolve this issue. So we can see, so this is the point that I wanted to make. So what happens here is that the systematic uncertainties of this excess emission, so these error bars are very large, and so a typical millisecond pulsar spectrum can still fit this excess. So, in fact, we find this is the best fit spectrum for the millisecond pulsars, and these are between 2 sigma of the best fit values of the average of the non-millisecond pulsars in the galactic, of the non-millisecond pulsars in globular clusters and in the field. So millisecond pulsars are still a valid explanation and perhaps the best motivated one. But this is not the only hypothesis. So one could think that perhaps, in this X shape, there are some old stars. One could think that something like star bursts, magnetic pulses in this X shape can accelerate electrons or cosmic rays and produce some extended gamma ray emission in this region. So definitely, millisecond pulsars is the best motivated solution, but there are some other alternatives and possible alternatives, definitely.
Okay.
Okay.
Germán seemed to it left. Okay, I can see a couple of questions from Santanu from the Q&A. So this person is asking, did I hear you correctly that the number of neutron stars is correlated with the dark matter density?
So what I wanted to say was that essentially this galactic center excess, what I wanted to say was that the galactic center excess is correlated with these infrared contour plots. So, and so what that means is that the galactic center is not spherically distributed, and that basically this favors the dark matter explanation. So hopefully that answers the question. So perhaps the question goes because previously with the interpolated gas maps, people found that the excess emission was spherically symmetric, and so an unresolved population of millisecond pulsars, which is a spherically distributed, could account for the excess, or also, of course, dark matter, because dark matter is expected to be as spherically symmetric. But now with our new gas maps, with our hydrodynamic gas maps, we are able to show that the galactic center excess is not as spherically distributed as one would expect for dark matter, but it's actually follows that X shape. So in the sense that X shape coincides with that X shape seen on the infrared, and the infrared is produced by all the stars, by some of the oldest stars in our galaxy, then those old stars are good tracers for millisecond pulsars. So while the dark matter hypothesis is disfavored, the millisecond pulsar alternative is actually now much more robust. It's actually much better motivated, I meant to say.
Okay, there are a couple of comments on the same line. First one again from Shantanu. So this person is saying that the reason I ask is that a few years back, Joseph Bramante had a paper arguing that the density of dark matter is anti-correlated with the density of neutron stars, since dark matter accretion on neutron stars changes them to black holes.
Okay, I see. So unfortunately, I'm not aware of that work. So I'm not able to answer properly that question, yes.
Okay, and there's a second comment, this time coming from Pedro. So he said that I think that the dark matter is not correlated with the excess, but the neutron stars are. The NFW profile should have at least a modest correlation with the central bulge. Hopefully the speaker can answer.
Let me go to the center. I hope I understand correctly the question, but the whole point of our paper is that definitely the gamma ray excess is correlated with the infrared emission. So it's not as spherically distributed as previous works show. So I see no reason why dark matter should have this X shape. So I do not understand why dark matter will have this X shape. However, as in this X, there are all the stars, and millisecond pulsars live with all the stars, then the millisecond pulsar hypothesis is much more likely. But definitely, I see no reason why dark matter should be correlated with this X. I'm not sure if I answered correctly the question, but that's the whole point I wanted to make. I hope I was able to successfully answer Pedro's question.
I think so. I see another question, this time come from Professor Palomares Ruiz. So he's asking, he said that you're considering four sigma significance to select the sources, but it seems that this is without taking into account the look elsewhere effect. I will expect this to reduce the significance in a non-obligatory way. Is that right?
Okay, let me go back to my point orders analysis. Let me go back to that. Okay, so in fact, we have using, so yeah, so I probably gave the impression that we were using only these four sigma significant detection for point sources, but in fact, we are also using a much more strict requirement for these point sources. So we use a TS value that is background dependent, and so essentially the point sources that are more likely to be real in the galactic center according to the Fermi-Ladd correlation are point sources that according to the number of photons in our field of view, so the TS should be larger than 80. So that means that the significant detection for a real point source in our analysis is definitely much larger. So we anyway show here use only a four sigma significant detection to look for the show the point sources candidates. So these are likely, so these are interesting point sources to look for multi-wavelength counterparts, but definitely the ones where we are pointing our finger that they are more likely to be real are the ones that have a TS larger than 80. So we are definitely not using only this TS of 25, but we are actually placing a much larger constraint for the more likely sources. So the sources that are found with a four sigma significance are interesting point sources, but they could be real or not. So they could be some features of the galactic background, for instance.
Okay.
So thanks. Yes.
So are there more questions for the audience? Well, I have one. So at the very beginning, you show the background used by Fermi, and one of these was called like loop one or loop A. I'm not sure. Can you please go back to that slide?
Okay, let me go back to that.
Yes, exactly that one. So what's this loop one template?
So unfortunately, there is no consensus of what loop one is, and so. Wolowin et al. So Wolowin has a model in which he proposes that loop one is just some local, is a couple of supernova remnants that are close to our solar system. And just because they are so close to our position, then they look like extended sources that go even up to the position of the Virgo cluster. That's to the best of my knowledge, probably the best model for that, but that's still not, so that's an open question. That's probably the best motivated model, but that's still an open question. So people don't know exactly what loop one is. But definitely people have seen this excess in the gamma rays. And
I see. So this template comes just from measurements.
So this template, yes. So this template, the template we are using here is the geometrical template proposed by Wolowin. And so so this guy used radio measurements to create his model, and then he did a fit to his radio measurements, and we are using that geometrical model to account for this structure in the galactic center. So this is not a data-driven. So this is not a data-driven gamma ray template in the galactic center. This is more a model that has been shown to explain well this structure at other wavelengths.
I see. Thanks.
Right.
So are there more questions?
Yeah, I have a couple. If I can ask them. So one question that I have is about when you are saying that there is no, I mean, there is no necessity of dark matter because of the data indicate that. I mean, you don't need to include it because you have already a good fit with your backgrounds and so on. So how is this compared to this necessity of, or not this necessity of dark matter with the analysis of dwarf galaxies? In which, at what time the dwarf galaxy analysis is gonna completely rule out this slightly indication of dark matter?
Right. Yeah. So that's something that I'm still working on. So I'm trying to work out what are the dark matter constraints from these analysis. So definitely, we are finding only one sigma significant detection for dark matter, and we expect to have strong constraints from dark matter. But compared to the dual spheroidal galaxies, I suspect we are going to get competitive constraints, but definitely dwarf spheroidal galaxies are going to provide much more some stronger constraints for dark matter models. So yes, so definitely dwarf spheroidals with the 45, something like 45 dwarf spheroidals that are known up to now, and doing the forecasting to almost 15 years of Fermilab data, one can definitely, yeah, so those upper limits found from dwarf spheroidals are going to be much stronger than these galactic center upper limits. But definitely, a one sigma significant detection in astrophysics is basically a null detection. It's essentially a null detection is not even an interesting significance to look for dark matter, and then what we need to do is just put constraints on dark matter models.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And another question, is there is a different analysis for the case of decaying dark matter in the galactic center or in the surrounding because the profile is
right. Yeah. So perhaps Herman Gomez Vargas is very knowledgeable about that. He's an expert on that. So what happens at the galactic center is that the NFW, so the density, so the expected flux in the galactic center, so it's proportional to the square of the dark matter density. Instead, for the decaying dark matter, you have only linear density, and so the galactic center is not the best place to look for the decaying dark matter. So instead, people look at higher latitudes where the expected decay dark matter signals are a bit larger compared to the background. So certainly, the galactic center is not a good place, or the galactic center is not a good place to look to place constraints in the for the kind of matter. Perhaps the inner galaxy or higher latitude of or analysis at higher latitudes. Definitely the galactic center is best for self-annihilating dark matter.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, sure.
And the last one, just to make a circle in this stuff. In this analysis, you are considering just the kind of this benchmark dark matter annihilation channels, no? I mean, in the sense there is no exotic annihilation processes.
Right. Kind yeah.
Of
so.
Bar, so, tau, and something.
Right. Yeah. So this analysis is completely model independent. So what we are doing is we are only assuming. In our analysis, we only assumed certain dark matter distribution. So we use an NFW profile with a slope of 1.2 and this smooth NFW with a slope of 1. So we use those two dark matter profiles. And then for the spectrum, we use a general spectrum. So essentially, the spectrum at every bin, so because we are doing a bin-by-bin analysis, so we are running the maximum likelihood analysis at every different bin. And so in that sense, the constraints or the spectrum that we get for dark matter is model independent. So the idea is that if you have a positive detection of dark matter with this technique, you can then fit your dark matter model to the excess emission. But in case of a null detection, as is our case, then we can essentially place upper limits, flux upper limits at every energy beam, and then place constraints on a certain dark matter candidate. So this is valid for a general dark matter model, and we can use this data to place constraints on every dark matter model. So we can make assumptions of the emission mechanisms and so forth.
So in some way, if there are theoreticians watching this webinar and they want to test their model, they have just to focus in some sense in the plot in the lower left, no?
That's correct. Yes. So that's correct. So in our paper, we are not yet showing the upper limits. So because these are so what we are planning to show here. What we intend to show here is that the galactic center excess is basically destroyed. But so the flux upper limits are not included in our paper. But someone interested can contact me, and I can send these upper limits. I'm planning to have a follow-up publication where I'm going to show the upper limits for that. But yeah, that's a solid point. I didn't include the flux upper limits. So this plot is merely to illustrative purposes. So it shows that the galactic center excess is destroyed once we account for these new components, the X-bulge, nuclear bulge, and the hydrodynamical gas maps. Right. So still from this data, we cannot place constraints because these are measurements. These are not upper limits. We cannot place constraints on dark matter models. So I will need to provide that data to the interested in this task.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure. Excellent. Okay.
Okay. I have another question. So sure. You say that this hypothesis of circular motion is not.
Sorry, Nicolas, I'm not hearing you now.
He's coming. Okay.
Can you hear me now, guys?
Thanks. Yes.
Okay. So at some point you say that, well, you comment that the circular motion is not a good hypothesis in the innermost part of the galaxy. So when you say like this center is what? What exactly? I mean, how many kiloparsecs per instance?
What happens is that this galactic bar, so it's well established that our galaxy possesses this galactic bar of stars, and so the gravitational potential of these stars induce highly non-circular motion of gas in this region. So essentially the gas in this region is moving so it's not moving in circular motion in this region. And then to have kinematical resolution towards the region, we need to perform hydrodynamical simulations, definitely.
Okay, see, but what's the size of this galactic bar?
This is 20 degrees across, if I'm correct. So this is something like 20 degrees in longitude. So from our location, because you can see that from our location, this galactic bar is inclined. So we are more or less here. And so approximately speaking, this is minus, so this is 10 degrees in longitude, and this is minus 10 degrees in longitude as well. So from our location, that's 20 degrees across the sky from our position, because you can see that, the galactic bar is inclined from our position.
Okay, I see.
Sure.
Thanks. So sure. Are there more questions? Maybe last one? So I don't think that's the case. So let's thank Oscar again for the super talk. And I want to remind you guys that in 2 weeks from now, so it's the 15th, I think, I will have another webinar now this time I forgot. Okay, about axions and the MagMAT experiment by Javier Redondo. Sorry. Okay, so thanks a lot, guys, and in particular to you, Oscar.
Okay, and thanks, Nicolas. Great, excellent. See you around.
Yes,
thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Nicolas. See you guys.